say IIoT, what comes to mind? Lots of sensors? Sure. Industry 4.0? Absolutely. Sleek design? Well, maybe not. Yes, there are a lot of different considerations that come into play when we're working on an industrial Internet of Things design. Integrated connectivity, scalability, and heat dissipation, to name just a few. And the packaging we choose can make a huge difference in getting all of those IIoT components to play nicely together. And guess what? It can look cool, too. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Today's industrial landscape is changing rapidly. And to keep up with the demands of Industry 4.0, we need to take a closer look at the packaging for our IIoT designs. In today's Chalk Talk, Joel Boone from Phoenix Contact joins me to discuss the unique packaging challenges of IIoT designs, how modularity and scalability come into play, and how Phoenix Contact can help you with your next IIoT design. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about this topic from Phoenix Contact. Hi, Joel. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Well, thank you, Amelia. It's great to be here. Really excited to talk with you today.
Excellent. Well, today we are talking about IIoT. But Joel, what should we be considering when it comes to the design of an IIoT product?
Right. Thanks for that question. I do want to start by saying most IIoT designs that we run into are doing one of the four things you see on the screen there: controlling, monitoring, converting, communicating. Really, IIoT design is all about getting information at a local level into the cloud most times and being able to process that information remotely and take action remotely as opposed to having all the control locally. So really connecting devices on a much larger scale. Some of the things that designers are considering as they do start to weigh how they're going to get that information up into the cloud is how we get access to secure that access, to have visualization locally for people who are next to the devices and what needs monitoring. There's a lot of diversity when it comes to the applications we're seeing within the IIoT world and device design. There's the need for connections to match, which requires a lot of diversity and connectivity, D-subs, RJ45s. There's just a lot of ways for information to be passed between devices and then eventually up into the cloud. And you got to have a lot of ability to make sure the scale of a design matches the application's needs. Every application can be different when it comes to the amount of I/O that's going to be processed. There's also a factor of making sure that we don't take up too much space. Designs really are shrinking all the time when it comes to any electronics, but that's very true in IIoT designs. We want to make sure that things stay small and don't take up much space in a control cabinet. That real estate is precious. We have to make sure that designs and enclosures to match those designs really stay nice and compact. Heat dissipation, of course, becomes a concern anytime you shrink electronics. So that's also a consideration that any designer has to tackle when thinking about an IIoT design. Also, industrial grade. That's the space that we'll be talking, I think, a lot about today. And that means it's something is proven that there's not going to be issues with it down the road, that it's going to run for years to come. But also aesthetics. The device has to look very clean, and that is a concern for any designer as well.
That makes sense. Now, Joel, it seems like there are more and more IIoT designs these days. How are you seeing these devices playing a role in each of the different IIoT markets?
From my view, industrial, obviously, is the first letter in IIoT, but that doesn't mean typically that industrial automation is the only area, the only market where IIoT design comes into play. Industrial automation is absolutely part of it, but process automation, new energies also play a vital role when it comes to thinking about IIoT. And within those three markets, we see a lot of different types of devices, a lot of different applications where IIoT devices are proliferating right now. So we have interface modules handling I/O, full-blown control systems, but also specifically communication devices, gateway modules, edge node computing. These are IIoT devices, and all of the things that I just mentioned about design considerations really come into play with those types of devices that are very very large need for those types of devices right now. Monitoring devices, energy storage also play a part in this IIoT world.
Okay, so Joel, can you give me an example of a real world IIoT design?
There's many, many different form factors, but the most pleasing and off-the-shelf type designs tend to be very clean, handling connection technology in a very simplified but easy-to-use manner. And so I've got this little animation that I wanted to share with you that really walks us through the important factors in a design. This new industrial case system from Phoenix Contact incorporates a lot of different design connection technology right into the layout of the entire enclosure. It's very easy to mix and match different connection technologies as needed in a different application. You can see RJ45s, USBs, D-subs, antennas all integrate directly into the packaging. There's an important bus connection that we'll talk about here in a few minutes that really helps a designer think about the future of their devices and different applications and different scales for different applications. But all in all, it's a very clean, aesthetically pleasing look for a designer that incorporates all their given needs when it comes to a packaging for their next IIoT design.
All right. So Joel, what are the key elements we should be looking at, especially for these kind of IIoT designs? What is really critically important to think about here?
Well, different designs require different approaches to the electronics. Some design manufacturers have a situation where they're going to need to put multiple boards in one type of package. And to break that out over multiple packages would be a design nightmare. So having something slightly larger while still taking up as minimal amount of space on the DIN rail in a control cabinet is vital. Other designers have very slim components and all surface mount components, and therefore a very slim packaging option is what they're looking for. So having different options in the same form factor is really important, and it allows a manufacturer to design a suite of products. So that's an important part of looking at packaging. Another important element of packaging is to look at the assembly of the product, production floor assembly. So when you go to design a product, if you don't have that in mind, you can definitely upset some internal customers when you go into your design phase. You need to keep in mind how this is going to be put together. Critically important in IIoT is flexibility of connectivity. RJ45s are prevalent right now. USBs, micro USBs, antennas for wireless communication to get information up into the cloud. But we still have the need for field wireable connections to handle I/O directly to devices. So being able to incorporate that all into one packaging system is really critical when it comes to IIoT designs. And last but not least, scalability. The ability to communicate between devices produced that you might want to design without having to do hard wiring between devices. Oh, designers love that ability to not have to worry about field wiring going between adjacent modules to handle communication and power distribution. So this T-bus connector that was shown in that animation just a minute ago can be incorporated to handle that requirement. And that is a huge, huge part of scaling an entire suite of products.
Okay, so let's talk about that scalability. That's an important aspect of any IIoT design, right? Talk more about how that comes into play here.
Right, so having a way to eliminate that wiring we established is pretty critical. The way this T-bus works, Phoenix Contact has developed this bus connector that kind of acts like a backplane connector, so to speak. It sits in the well of the DIN rail. It's an 8-position connector. You can run power, you can run signal, you can have parallel communication, or you can have serial communication such that if you remove a device, that communication string is actually interrupted, which allows a designer to think about, oh, I can provide my customer the ability to know when a module goes offline due to repair. I can monitor that remotely. Again, huge aspect of IIoT. So like I said, 8-position connector, gold-plated so that we have no problems with signal integrity when you're mating and unmating in enclosure from the rail, a design from the rail piece of electronics. And everything a customer would need in terms of communication between devices can be handled by this one connector.
Now, Joel, I am definitely seeing more system on module or computer on modules these days. How do you see them playing a role in these kind of designs?
I completely agree, Amelia. This is definitely the way the market is going when it comes to a lot of future designs and existing designs. IIoT is demanding that we be able to, as designers, the design community, needing to kind of farm out some of the design work, taking dedicated modules that already exist to fill out a suite of products. Take temperature measurement, for instance. If a design company is really good at controls, developing controls, and really monitoring digital I/O, but temperature isn't something maybe they focused on in the past, temperature measurement in their suite of products, they can now go to a system on module or a computer on module that has that dedicated functionality and integrate it with their existing suite of products, their existing electronics. So that's a huge step forward for the industry to be able to offer full service products where maybe a layer of expertise had not been completely developed within a device manufacturer. So that's really important. It does come with some trade-offs, but it is really easy to incorporate. It greatly reduces the amount of R&D invested on the front end. Now, what happens with these system on module or computer on module devices, as you integrate them into, say, a carrier board, there is a little bit of extra heat, a little bit of extra thermal issues that come as a result, and power dissipation becomes an incredible challenge at times, but an important challenge for designers to overcome.
All right. So speaking of heat, what kinds of heat and power dissipating are we really talking about here?
Great question. Any device that has any amount of heat that's generated, doesn't matter where it is, we don't have to be talking about an industrial control situation that needs to get heat out of it. The easiest way for heat to dissipate and get out is to have radiation. That is the most effective, emanating from whatever the heat source is directly out in all directions. One of the problems in an industrial control cabinet, as you stack devices and instruments and everything together on a DIN rail, is you really can't get that heat to emanate out the way the heat wants to via radiation. You have a stacking principle that constricts that air movement and doesn't allow that type of heat dissipation to occur. Also, the most common materials used for these cases, these enclosures, tends to be plastic. And that's a good insulating material for electrical purposes, but it's also an insulating material for thermal purposes. So you're not going to get just natural radiation typically from out of a plastic enclosure. So that's one issue that design manufacturers have to consider. So the next way that heat can get out of one of these boxes, one of these enclosures, would be through convection. And so Phoenix Contact has developed a good amount of enclosures that have venting already built into them. And so the one we're talking about today, the industrial case system, definitely has options for venting built into it. And that would be, as you see on the screen here, basically pulling cool air in from below the device and having hot air exit through the top of the device just through natural airflow convection without any secondary process, no fanning needed. It just kind of pulls the air thanks to the way of, well, frankly, how thermodynamics work. And then there's conduction. That's the other way that manufacturers have to lean to if radiation and convection aren't sufficient for cooling the device. If things are still running too hot to operate safely long-term, conduction is usually the method we all turn to transfer the heat from the hot spot, from the place generating heat within the design, to getting that heat outside the design, outside the packaging.
Okay, so Joel, what kind of solution should we be looking at here?
Well, the most common one for industrial designs, frankly, designs of all nature when it comes to electronics, is to move towards heat sinks. That's a very simple, straightforward, and proven technology that will allow a designer to ensure that the heat gets dissipated properly from their device and that their devices stay cool, the critical components are able to operate the way they're supposed to for an extended period of time. So heat sinks are a major portion of heat dissipation. And I had this animation to show representing some hot spots on a printed circuit board going into the industrial case system. A little bit of thermal analysis suggests that it may be too hot to operate on a long-term basis. So we simply mill out some portions on a heatsink, incorporate it directly into the enclosure, and that takes care of the problem. So you can see the milling process here. You can see a TIM material to transfer the heat to the heatsink from the hotspot, still in a nice compact package and completely integrated. That's what's different about this packaging, is that we can incorporate heatsinks. We've developed heatsinks that incorporate directly into the packaging, which is very different. Most packaging designs either are aluminum, moving away from the plastic style of enclosure like we talked about a minute ago. And if you have aluminum, it does dissipate heat easily, but then you have a very hot device. And Furthermore, aluminum costs more than plastic, so incorporating a heat sink directly into a plastic enclosure is a great way to compensate for the poor insulation properties, thermal insulation properties of plastic, while still maintaining a less expensive solution that is industrial grade and still aesthetically pleasing, all the things that we've been talking about so far.
That makes sense. Now, Joel, thermal management is also a big concern for IIoT designs, right? What kind of thermal management solutions should we be looking at?
Right. So we've talked about venting now. We've talked about heat sinks, and these are the things that are directly incorporated. But some other things that we should be talking about here are thermal analysis is a big deal for designers. It's something that is not easily done for some design houses, some design OEMs. Sometimes that can be a very big hurdle, and it's something that maybe a designer may not be equipped to handle on their own. They just simply don't have enough time. They don't have the resources to tackle thermal analysis. So another thing that we're offering along with the components that we've talked about is the ability to offer that service to a designer. We can offer to a customer thermal analysis free of charge directly from our website. We offer the ability to add up to 3 hotspots in a design, and we would return to you within 48 hours a report that suggests where you may need to potentially take a look at hotspots, or if your design is fine as is in this enclosure with the venting that's already built in and that type of thermal dissipation directly through the venting, the convection that would occur. So we can provide that support for a designer who does not have the time or the bandwidth or the resources to tackle that type of analysis on their own.
Okay, great. Now, Joel, this has been a lot to take in today. Can you wrap up your main points for me? What should we be really considering when it comes to IIoT packaging?
Thanks, Amelia. It is a lot to take in, but really, to condense it all down, designs need to be scalable. This packaging absolutely will help a designer keep their thoughts, their processes, and their designs in a very scalable format to match whatever applications they may run into. The connection technology diversity is really important. It simplifies what modifications might need to be done to the enclosure. When you incorporate connection technology directly into, and all of this connection technology directly into the packaging, you free yourself up to not have to worry about modifying the enclosure in any way, shape, or form. You can personalize the design through color changes and digital printing. These are ways to make the packaging look aesthetically pleasing. But again, these are options. They can, right out of the box, be very easy to use and implement immediately. Displays and keypads can be directly implemented in the enclosure without having to modify the enclosure in any way, shape, or form either. That's an important feature for visualization, as we touched on at the beginning, for a designer to know that their customer can interact with their electronics easily and quickly as needed. And again, thermal management is a huge issue when it comes to shrinking electronics, and this packaging system has that cover between the venting and the heat sinks that can be incorporated directly into it. So when you take all of these things into consideration, this industrial case system really is the perfect casing system for IIoT designs.
Excellent. So Joel, if my audience wants to learn more, where should they go for more information?
Yes, we've created a landing page, phoenixcontact.com/ICS. where you can learn all about the system, the components that go into it. But most importantly, you can configure your own. As I mentioned earlier, the connection technology is completely swappable and can go wherever you want it to in the enclosure system. So you can literally drag and drop using our online configurator and create your own bill of materials, get your own CAD file where you can start to actually think about how the design would work out. And thermal management is baked directly into that configuration, so you can actually upload a design and analyze whether or not additional thermal management steps might be needed. So there's also how to build videos, how to assemble the product together. It's a really informative website, and I encourage your listeners to check it out.
Excellent. Well, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me, Joel.
Thank you, Amelia. It's my pleasure.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from Phoenix Contact. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/eejournal.